Welcome our Eastern Vice Chancellor, Lieutenant General Dr. N. D. Venkatesh, for agreeing to deliver his business remarks. I welcome all invitees, faculty, research scholars, and students to this distinguished lecture. Sir, you have led India's nuclear establishment for decades and have contributed significantly in terms of India being perceived as a responsible nuclear player. Nuclear being a dual-use technology, how India remained isolated from the mainstream and how now India has started negotiating for a position of strength. All this, we have learned from you how the things really got transitioned into the current context. India's nuclear power generation has witnessed a lot of impediments. There cannot be a better person other than you to provide an objective assessment on the imperatives for nuclear power in India. It is not an easy task for me to introduce you, but I will make an attempt, and it's my pleasure duty to say a few words about your contribution. Dr. Neil Karkolkar has worked for the development of the atomic energy program in India throughout his professional career. He joined the Bhabha Atomic Research Center in 1964, following the 1 year postgraduate training with top rank in nuclear science and technology in the then atomic energy establishment. He then became the director of Bhabha Atomic Research Center in the year 1996, and then he became the chairman of Atomic Energy Commission and secretary to the Government of India, Department of Atomic Energy, during the years 2000 to 2009. Afterwards, he became Department of Atomic Energy Homeopathy Chair Professor during 2010 to 2015, and then he was also Indian National Academy Engineering Satish Dhawan Chair of Engineering Eminence during January 2015. His focus of work has been on how India really has become self-reliant in the nuclear reactor system, and we are going to hear from him that how India really faced those challenges, and obviously the title, which again reflects most of these contemporary issues in India's imperative for nuclear power in the current context. And obviously he has been contributed significantly in terms of conducting R&D on the various phases of India's nuclear cycle. Dr. Karkolkar continues to be actively involved in programs related to the augmentation of thorium utilization in our nuclear power program and for the development of non-fossil primary energy sources for meeting our overall energy needs. He has been a key contributor to India's strategic program as well. He was amongst the chosen few involved in first successful nuclear experiment which India conducted at Pokhran in 1974. Later, he again played a very important role in the series of successful nuclear tests which India conducted in 1998, because at that point in time, he was the director of Bhabha Atomic Research Center. India also demonstrated nuclear submarine power pack technology under Dr. Karkolkar's leadership. In fact, his CV is quite huge. Obviously, I will not take much time in the context of recognizing you, all of you know him very well. His contributions are well known across the globe. Sir, we are very delighted to have you in this our distinguished lecture series. Before I request you to deliver your lecture, I would like our Vice Chancellor to give his presidential remarks.
Thank you, Professor Anand Kumar. Good evening, everybody. Dr. Anil Karkolkar, Chairman, Rajiv Gandhi Science and Technology Commission and formerly Secretary, Department of Atomic Energy. Faculty, invitees, research scholars, students, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, I take this opportunity to offer a very hearty welcome to Dr. Anil Karkolkar to this distinguished lecture organized by the Department of Geopolitics and International Relations on a very pertinent and timely theme, Imperatives for Nuclear Power, India's Experience. Sir, we at MAHE are delighted that you were able to accept our invitation and be part of this distinguished lecture series. And I'm sure your experience, words of wisdom, and your scholarship will offer great insights to our students and scholars after this lecture. In the emerging scenario where the debates on environmental security and climate change are gaining momentum, nuclear energy seems to be emerging as the most preferred options if there is going to be an emission-free world. The energy generation through nuclear component does not emit carbon, and more concentration of greenhouse gas in the atmosphere, more and more challenges for the climate change. India has come a long way in improving the nuclear component of its energy security constituents. There's no denying the fact that India's nuclear energy program most of the time has worked under huge constraints and stress. The constraints because of the lack of indigenous sufficient nuclear fuel, uranium, and the disruption in supply from the rest of the world. The nuclear program has witnessed stress because of various embargoes, technological sanctions imposed by those who had the technology as well as nuclear fuel. The United States had taken a lead in bringing all measures which were supposedly proven to be detrimental to India's nuclear industry after Pokhran 1 in 1974. The United States wanted to impose sanctions on India and also to contain its ambitions to emerge as a nuclear power. But it was because of India's resilience and the work done by members of the nuclear scientific community, the sanctions proved to be a boon in disguise. India did pay the price in terms of time and money, but it surely became self-reliant in terms of nuclear technology. And in a true sense, Atmanirbhar, as our Prime Minister would put it. India's commitment to enhance its nuclear power generation was reflected in building 14 indigenously built pressurized heavy water reactors. India has imported boiling water reactor from USA and pressurized water reactor from Russia and elsewhere. In addition to peaceful use of nuclear power and power generation, India also, over the decades, developed a credible nuclear deterrence. And this has held India's security concerns with at an arm's length. And India has always been a very, very responsible nuclear power and adhered to all international treaties and guidelines in its true form. And in addition to developing credible nuclear deterrence, the country also has developed the delivery systems to go alongside. The quantum shift in the approaches, US approaches to India, got culminated into an Indo-US Civil Nuclear Cooperation Agreement, the so-called 123 Agreement. This agreement is not only an agreement with the US, but it also opened up for India to conduct nuclear trade and commerce with all 48 members of the Nuclear Suppliers Group. We are very fortunate today to have Dr. Kakodkar with us, who has spearheaded India's nuclear program, both in the field of civil nuclear application and military applications. We will be hearing from him about India's experience and imperatives for nuclear power, the nuclear power projections made by India, and how far we have come to realize our goal, despite the impediments in our third stage of nuclear fuel cycle. Once again, sir, we are thankful to you for providing this opportunity to all the students and the faculty to learn from and know from you the challenges and prospects for nuclear power. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now I request Dr. Anil Kakodkar to deliver his address.
Well, thank you, Lieutenant General Dr. Venkatesh, Vice Chancellor of MAHE, Dr. Arvind Kumar, Professor and Head of, Manipal is one of the few places where you have a formal academic activity which looks into strategic issues. It's a great pleasure for me to know that Sri Seshadri Chari also is there, and he's also a part of this audience. And dear students, members of faculty, and indeed everybody who is a part of this particular lecture. Thank you very much for this opportunity to be able to talk to all of you I have come to Manipal a number of times. Only thing is, this time I have to give this lecture in this online mode because of the situation we are in, not just in our country, but the world over. As you all know, India's nuclear program has several dimensions, and in fact, the program incorporates all dimensions that a nuclear program can have. And we are right from day one, the objective of the program was to do everything that the country might need, leveraging nuclear science and technology. As we all know, today the issues related to climate change are staring at us. They are becoming more serious day by day. And nuclear power can play a big role, and particularly a country like India, which as General mentioned, we have the self-reliant capability in nuclear power technology as well. And so I think India can do a lot to address requirements of the country, but also to address requirements of the world. And so I think while we are facing this challenge, I think we have also a significant opportunity for India going forward. And of course, the opportunity won't present itself on its own. One has to work to get that opportunity in action and leverage those opportunities for our national benefit. And that's broadly what I'm going to talk about. Can we go to the next slide? Can we have the next slide? Yeah. Now, we are all talking about the need for clean energy, keeping the carbon emission under control, and so on and so forth. And that has a close relationship with the energy requirements, and energy requirement in turn has very close relationship to development, particularly for a country like India, because if you are already at the very high level of energy use, then it doesn't matter how much energy you use. As you can see in the graph or the figure on the top left hand corner, the countries represented by blue triangles, they are all advanced countries, and they're put on a chart. Y-axis is human development index and x-axis energy consumption, and you would notice that they have reached the highest possible level of human development index. And so little more energy, little less energy, it's not going to make much difference for them. Then there are countries which are represented by red squares, countries which have average quality of life. And these countries are in transition, in the sense they're close to reaching the level of advanced countries. And at the same time, at the other end of the transition, they are more like developing countries. And then green rhombuses, the countries represented by green rhombuses, and India is one of them. These are countries where the quality of life is actually low. And so I was talking about these countries, and here you add energy, you in fact make a big difference to the Human Development Index quality of life. As far as India is concerned, you know, we should aim at from where we are to a point where we reach that asymptotic transition, which is represented by that vertical bar, which is at 2,400 kilogram oil equivalent per person. And so to reach this high Human Development Index, comparable with advanced countries of the world, it's clear that we need something like 4 to 5 times more energy than what we use presently. So this is one challenge, and we have to still fulfill this requirement, aspiration, need, whatever you may call it, even as we are all concerned with the climate change. Now, as I said, climate, of course, is a global issue, and whatever any country, particularly large country, does, it affects the entire globe. Now, the table in the middle top, it actually lists the top 10 carbon emitters in the world. These are 2018 data, but I think it's largely valid. Out of these top 10 carbon emitters, in fact, all countries at the Paris, we had, you know, every country, they indicated their voluntary declarations as to what kind of contributions they would make in terms of avoiding carbon emission. And of course, we all know that the sum total of all those promised contributions was found to be inadequate to keep the global warming to within 2 degrees. That was the target at that time. And in fact, even if everything got implemented, and there is doubt whether that will be implemented, but even if everything is implemented, it would end up in something like 3.5 degrees or 3.7 degrees Celsius global warming. On the other hand, it has now come about that we should actually reduce the warming to 1.5 degrees above the pre-industrial level. And so there is a further IPCC report. In fact, it's titled as IPCC report for 1.5 degrees Celsius warming, something like that. And the feeling is, that 2 degrees itself may be too much, and we should actually aim at 1.5 degrees. And of course, you are getting actual experience. We are witnessing the impact of adverse impact of climate change. And so, and the next conference of parties, it was to be this year. Now it will be in November next year at Glasgow. And different countries are preparing strategies as to how to deal with this conference of parties on one side, and to get some kind of global consensus going beyond Paris. Now, if you look at the table, among the top 10 carbon emitters, 5 of them have already announced an year by which they will reach zero emission. For example, China has announced that it would target reaching zero emission by 2060. Likewise, Japan, Germany, Korea, Canada, they all have announced that they would reach zero emission by 2050. And in the next slide, I will show you what is the importance of reaching zero emission by 2050. It is actually related to 1.5 degrees warming, which we are all aspiring for. Even United States, of course, they walked out of Paris, and we can hope that with the new administration led by Joe Biden, they will come back into the Paris process. But I read somewhere that the new president designate has in fact expressed his intention to adopt year 2050 as a cutoff date to eliminate carbon emission completely. In fact, California as a state, they already have this target with them. So that leaves six countries among the top 10 emitters. India is at number three. So that covers six countries and that leaves four countries. And India is the top emitter among these four, followed by Russia, and then somewhere down at number eight is Iran, and number nine is Saudi Arabia. So that is the company we are in right now. While we have serious challenge, and that's what I'm going to talk about, and the role nuclear power can play. But I think we need to note that world is getting ready to reach zero emission goal by 2050. And we must decide clearly what is it that we want to do. Fortunately, India has enough clean energy resources to meet our energy needs in full, even to support the highest level of Human Development Index. The challenge is that we have not deployed the right technologies on the right scale. And so, of course, we are dependent on coal, which we have in plenty. And we are dependent on a tremendous quantity of oil. Most of our oil we import, very little is domestically produced. So I don't want to get into details of the table, which is there on the top right hand side. But the simple point that we need to note is the clean energy resources to meet our energy needs are in fact available on Indian landmass. Can we go to the next slide, please? Yeah. Now, as I was mentioning, we have, for example, this 1.5 degrees to kind of limit the global warming to 1.5 degrees above pre-industrial level. Now, staying below 1.5 degrees Celsius in 2100, by the turn of the century, would require cuts in greenhouse gas emissions of 45% below 2010 levels by 2030 and to net zero by 2050. And that is where you see those country by country saying net zero, net zero. Whether they will actually achieve that, we'll have to see. But there is that message which countries are trying to give. We thus have only 10 years to realize deep emission cuts and 30 years, that is up to 2050, to reach zero emission while addressing development aspirations of much of the world. Now, if you want to have deployment on such large scale, we must start actions now. And not because, you know, if you start research and development now, by the time we'll develop mature technology and deploy, I think it will become too late. Of course, we should develop new technologies. Technologies that can never be static. But in terms of climate change, I think we must start action now, leveraging available and rapidly deployable technologies so that we achieve our goal. So I think that's an important point. You know, many people talk about new technology and all. New technology takes time to mature, and by the time we'll miss this target. Nothing against, I think technology development must continue because technology has to evolve. But in terms of climate change challenge, I think this is a very important point. Now, of course, we are all stressing rightly very high on renewable energy, and that is an important deployment option. But while that is so, nuclear power can make a vital contribution to meeting zero emission target while delivering the increasingly large quantities of baseload electricity needed for global economic development. Now, we must distinguish that most of the renewable energy, they are variable. Whereas nuclear is perhaps, you know, there are other theoretically, but in terms of practical application, particularly for a country like India, nuclear is the only clean energy source which can provide baseload electricity in large quantities, copious quantities. And there are studies, particularly the MIT studies, and I'm going to talk about this in the next slide, but which have in fact very clearly established that without nuclear contribution, the cost of achieving deep decarbonization targets, that cost will increase very high, very significantly. And I will show you how high these costs are, particularly in the context of Germany. But I think this is the point, this is the message that I want to drive, that we must take, you know, we have this some kind of very short-sighted, myopic financial view, which says nuclear is expensive and solar is cheap. Actually, that is a misplaced notion. This is a notion at the level of the project. At the project level, there are many hidden costs, whereas in nuclear, those hidden costs are not there. And I'll come to that in the next slide. But actually, it is for the at the national level. I'm not talking about the project level, but at the country's level, it is actually cheaper to have a larger contribution of nuclear to reach the low carbon objective. Can we go to the next slide? Now, this slide is a busy slide, but don't bother too much about the number. I'll explain what the sum and substance of that is. But this is actually the part of the summary of the MIT study, which I one line conclusion I mentioned in the previous slide. This study actually, there are several scenarios they have looked at. What is seen in this figure is a comparison, basically, of they have looked at the average system cost, not the project cost, but this system cost of electricity. And so that several scenarios they have seen. One scenario is that there will be no nuclear. We'll try to achieve our objective of zero emission only by renewable energy. Other scenario is we'll have, along with renewable energy, we'll have nuclear, but nuclear at nominal costs, whatever are the current capital costs of nuclear energy, that is what will be considered. And the third scenario is that you will talk about nuclear with, you know, more advanced technologies where you can set them up at a lower capital cost. And on the left-hand side of this figure, it actually talks about the average generation cost at the system level, overall system level. And the three bars are actually the three scenarios I mentioned. In the report, there are many scenarios, but just to understand what they are trying to say. And it looks at an optimum solution. What is the cost optimum solution? The system cost, what is the minimum system cost? when we want to constrain emission to something like 500 gram CO2 per kilowatt hour electric, 100 gram, 50 gram, 10 gram, and on the extreme right-hand side, 1 gram. And they have done this study for a region in United States, New England, and similarly for a region in China, TBT region in China. And you would notice that, you know, we want to go to zero carbon emission. So you look at that block which covers the 1 gram emission of CO2 per kilowatt hour. And you would notice that average generation cost at low emissions without nuclear, that first bar, the tallest bar, is the one without nuclear. The average generation cost is roughly twice in that region, New England region in USA, and four times the other options in the TBT region, China. So that is the importance of having nuclear in the overall grid, and not, you know, this tariff comparison, which we all kind of sold. And I think this discourse in this country has completely changed. And I think we must correct that discourse. On the right-hand side of this same figure, see, on the left-hand side, we had the average generation cost. On the right-hand side, it talks about the penetration, the capacity, nuclear installed capacity as a percentage of peak demand. And of course, when you're talking about, we are not talking about no nuclear. So there are only two bars there. And the nuclear installed capacity as a percentage of peak demand, it turns out to be something like 60% in the United States and something like 80% in China. So if you want to achieve zero carbon or close to zero carbon, that is the importance of nuclear that has been brought out by the MIT study. And I think we need to do similar study, quantitative study in India. And I'm certain our numbers will be closer to China than America. So this is the important message that I want to give. And this is what we should aim at. Can we go to the next slide? Now, in contrast to that situation, look at what is happening. See, this figure talks about the change in the global energy-related CO2 emission and avoided emission in the year 1718. And a lot of efforts have been made to kind of reduce or avoid CO2 emission. But there is also a great increase because of economic growth. And the economic growth is primarily taking place in emerging economy countries. See, these advanced countries, as I said, they have reached saturation. Per capita electricity consumption doesn't have to increase there. So this is actually the contribution coming from the economic growth, which is primarily happening in emerging economy countries. India is, of course, one of them. And then there have been efforts to reduce, for example, energy efficiency, renewables, and so on and so forth. But if you see the sum total, the 2018 bar is actually higher compared to 2017 bar. So rather than reducing CO2 emission, our CO2 emission is actually going up. And that is because there are these global aspirations of getting developed comparable with the advanced countries. And why not? I think all of us in India should also have that ambition. So the challenge is, how do we manage our development, but at the same time ensure that we don't threaten the globe by, you know, the threat posed by climate change. Next slide, please. Next one, please. Yeah. Now, here are some suggested actions. Now, these are the actions which have to be taken at international level. And so I'm since I think you're all people in the strategic discourse, I'm mentioning this to you. But this is where diplomacy has to play a big role. I have defined three sets of actions for three sets of countries. And so I call them blue dot countries, which was the advanced countries in slide one, which were, you know, they were all along the horizontal line at the top. Now, in these countries, I think they should actually reduce their electricity consumption. And nothing will happen to Human Development Index by their reducing electricity consumption. They should also aim at decarbonizing electricity generation. And it's happening in many countries. And in both these, they can do without affecting their Human Development Index, which is already at a high level. And we saw that a little change in energy up or down, it doesn't make any difference. But these countries should agree to reduce electricity consumption and also decarbonize electricity generation. So this should be one global agenda. Now let's talk about the countries with average quality of life, you know, the countries which are between the poor countries and the advanced countries. Now these countries, of course, you know, there is development aspiration, they need electricity, and you have to address the climate change issue. So certainly these countries should give very high importance to increasing non-fossil electricity consumption. Rather than fossil electricity, we should emphasize on non-fossil electricity consumption, and that's happening in most of the world. It's happening in India as well. And of course, we should also decarbonize to the extent possible electricity generation. And if we do that, there will be positive impact on Human Development Index. And these are the countries which constitute a very large market. And most of them are emerging economic countries. And so there could be an economic case for green augmentation of green electricity in these countries. This is happening, but there is this cost. And of course, you have this, you know, the Clean Energy Fund, Global Energy Fund, which is doing a good job. I think India also, we are benefiting from this. The third set of countries are the countries which were represented by the green dot. And unfortunately, India still happens to be one among them. And I think the aim for this, I'm talking about all countries in that slot. I think it's important that we need improvement in energy access, including if it comes to by subsidies and major international action. And now in the global discourse, where India will be considered, I don't know. They may consider us in the red dot countries, but we really belong to green dot countries. But this is what will drive, in my mind, the huge negotiations and debate in the next conference of parties. Of course, I don't know if this may go this way, but at least this will be at the back of mind of people. They may articulate it differently because they may have different diplomatic strategies. But this is what we should really aim at. And can we go to the next slide? Next slide, yeah. Now, just to tell you a sharp contrast in terms of meeting climate change targets. And I had taken two countries from the advanced countries group, and this contrast is very, very striking. Take the case of Germany, and at the time of Paris, Germany said that they set goals for 2020, such as reduce greenhouse gas emission by 40%, reduce primary energy consumption by 20%, and increase share of renewables in energy consumption by 20%. And Germany, of course, took a very aggressive stance, and they have done a great job in terms of renewable energy. And Germany's total electricity production is 650 billion units annually, and they are producing roughly 50% of that today. So they have done a great job. They also announced phasing out of nuclear. Now, Germany, the nation that did more than any other country to unleash the modern renewable energy industry, is likely to fall short of its goals for reducing harmful carbon dioxide emission, even after spending 500 billion euros, which is equivalent to $580 billion, or it turns out to be greater than 40 lakh crores by 2025. That's what they are spending to overhaul its energy system. Their CO2 emission target, they are unlikely to meet. Now, in contrast, take Japan. And mind you, Japan is a country which suffered Fukushima. And so on one side, they have the Paris commitments. Other side, they are managing post-Fukushima energy mix. Now, at Paris, they committed that 2030, they would aim to reduce emissions by 26% from 2013 rates. Japan's electricity production is 1,100 billion units, much more than Germany. And 15% of that today is renewable. They have 10 more years to go to the target, 2030 target. But the interesting part is, in 2018, Japanese government revised its energy plan to update the 2030 target. For nuclear energy, now they say they will still have 20 to 22% nuclear energy in their energy mix by restarting reactors. And they are restarting reactors. You must be hearing that in newspaper. And recently, the local authorities, there is a nuclear power station closer to the source of Fukushima tsunami which destroyed Fukushima. There is a reactor which is even closer to that tsunami epicenter, closer compared to Fukushima. And one of that reactor they have decided to write off, but the other reactor, the local authorities have given permission and they are working to recommission that reactor. So that is the approach Japanese are taking. And along with that, they will have 27% LNG, 25% coal, 23% renewables, and 3% oil. The point I wish to make is a country which suffered Hiroshima, Nagasaki, which is where there is so much of apprehension about nuclear. They suffered an accident at Fukushima, which had the global impact, at least global impact on nuclear energy. But they have, and in fact, these are decisions taken at the level of their parliament and government, cabinet. So, so the short point I wish to make, discourse in our country, it is heavily perception based. And perception, I don't know who manages what. but one must go through a very deep rational thought. And this is more important for India because although we are far from our development target, today itself we are producing something like 1,600 billion units of electricity annually, which is even more than Japan. So that is the importance of taking rational decisions. So I am going to now make a case for nuclear energy in India, but also nuclear energy in the world as a whole. Because even these emerging economic countries, the penetration of nuclear energy is rather slow. It's growing. For example, even a country like United Arab Emirates, you know, Arab country, oil-rich country, they have set up nuclear power plants. Saudi Arabia is talking about setting up nuclear power plants. So something is happening, but if you want to keep this zero emission by 2050, then the growth of nuclear power in emerging economic countries is rather slow. And reasons are for that are not very hard to imagine. There are apprehensions about nuclear power, and we need a system, reactor system, that can allay those fears, allay those apprehensions. And we have to do that on the basis of a currently available proven technology. There is no time for doing new development for that purpose, as I mentioned to you. So it seems to me that India has a great opportunity in terms of projecting our heavy water reactors. And we, of course, use heavy water reactors with uranium. And that is one way of looking at that. But the same heavy water reactor, if you fuel it by low enriched uranium thorium fuel, then it does wonderful things. In the sense, the fuel requirement, the spent fuel arising, becomes a factor of eight lower because the burn up goes up. It gives much higher energy. Secondly, there is, in terms of cost, there is some amount of saving. And more importantly, thorium, it actually runs cooler compared to uranium. And its melting point is higher. So it gives you some significant safety benefits. So the point I'm making is, why not project LEU thorium fueled Indian heavy water reactor, particularly the smaller one, 220 megawatt electric reactor, as a model for green energy in emerging economic countries. And if you do that, I think you will make a great contribution to reaching that target globally. And of course, it means huge to India's economy. You can imagine the boost this will give to manufacturing sector. And also, we can leverage. For example, we have cooperation agreement with the United States, which is, of course, we are able to get uranium from outside, but it, not producing whatever was expected. We can leverage that agreement to make a global impact. And that is where diplomacy has to be kind of brought into play. So I think that is the point, that we have more than a dozen reactors with long high performance track record. In fact, one of them held the world record of longest uninterrupted run till very recently, as long as 962 days. Specific capital cost is better than light water reactors which are available in global market. The fuel, as I said, have the high burn up, so it is within the existing technology, but you can reduce the spent fuel, you can make the fuel proliferation resistant, and quick deployment is possible, but because everything is proven. So I think India has a golden opportunity to contribute to the global climate control and also to contribute to Indian economy by doing this. And I sincerely hope that this would become a part of a strategic dialogue internationally. Now, with that little statement about what we should do in the international domain, let's come back to domestic program. What is it that we need to do? Now, to reach that high human development index or 5,000 kilowatt hour per capita, that is the threshold where there is a knee of that correlation, it amounts to something like generation of 8,000 billion units as against 1,600 billion units that we are generating today. Now, let's say for the time being that we will have at least 50% of that coming from renewable energy. Now, that would mean we need to set up something like 2,500 gigawatts of renewable energy capacity as against the current capacity of 83 gigawatts. 37 wind, 32 solar, 10 bio, and then small hydro, 4. And then let us say that remaining 50% should be baseload, because you can't have everything variable. Grids won't work like that. And we saw that the cost implication in that MIT study. So 50% coming from baseload, which will amount to something like 600 gigawatts, as against the current baseload capacity of 282 gigawatts. But most of it comes from hydro, thermal, 230 gigawatts, 45 comes from hydro, and 7 comes from nuclear. Now, we cannot avoid carbon, but there is pressure on reducing carbon utilization. So what is the way? And so I have been saying, and people, in fact, the academic pundits think that I'm talking out of hat, and I have not seen any study to the contrary. So they also talk out of hat or cook some results. Sorry to use such harsh words. But to me, it looks that going forward, we need to increase renewable capacity by 30-fold. Compared to what we have today, 83 to 2,500. We need to increase nuclear capacity also 30-fold, so that from current 7 gigawatts will go to something like 210, 220, that kind of level for nuclear. And recognize that that is still short of the requirements of baseload electricity. And the only way to reach zero carbon emission while still using carbon for the remaining thing, my gut feeling is that you need to kind of get remaining from coal, but you have to double the carbon, including the replacement. Some carbon coal plants will have to be phased out because they are old. So you have to replace them plus double the existing capacity. Then only you can realize this. So these targets look astronomical, but that is because of inaction over so much of long period. And I think we need to catch up if we want to protect the earth. And so what do we do with this carbon while you have to be zero emission? And that you have to manage through leveraging technologies for carbon capture, carbon utilization, and carbon sequestration. And some small scale work is going on right now, but we need to accelerate that. And clearly, if this is not done, what it would mean is that you will have larger share of renewable energy, which would cost the nation much more, as you saw in the first study. And at the same time, you will not be able to reach the zero emission target. So I think we need to be very ambitious on the home front to deploy this energy mission, clean energy mission. In fact, the language should change. Rather than calling it renewable energy, we should call it clean energy, where nuclear is a part. And that kind of includes everything, renewable as well as nuclear. So that is the challenge. I think India has huge capability, particularly our youth and science and technology resource must be leveraged to realize this. Now, where are we today? At the moment, next slide, please. Next slide. I think I talked about this. Sorry, this is also I mentioned. So sorry about that. I should have brought this slide. Next slide. Yeah. So today we have 22 operating nuclear units. 9 units are under construction. 12 units, the projects have been approved and work is going on. And there are 23 units under planning. So this constitutes a total of 66 units, which will contribute to something like 49 gigawatts, way short of what the target said. And that is where I think we need to do much more. And of course, you can question me that our implementation rate is much lower. So how can we talk about that? And I must concede that point. But I think if you want to protect the earth and protect this country, I see no other option. Next slide, please. Now, see, electricity is an important part of energy supply. But there are other forms of energy that also we require, particularly fluid energy. You know, we require oil, we require gas. For transportation, for industry, and so on and so forth. And so we should also talk about decarbonizing energy segments which are outside electricity domain. Now, this we need to understand, and this table in the figure, it talks about energy resources on one side, left-hand side, and consuming sectors on the other side. And our challenge is to leverage energy resources and reach them in a convenient form to the consuming sectors. This could be in the form of electricity, it could be in the form of oil, it could be in the form of gas, it could be as solid coal or any other solid energy source. Now, it's very clear that going forward, the role of electricity would increase, role of oil would decrease, role of gas would increase, because I think outlook for gas is globally is better than oil, but more importantly, gas is cleaner than oil, and the role of solid is also likely to decrease. And so this transition, generating electricity and taking it to other sectors where electricity was not used earlier, for example, electric mobility, or generating electricity or generating hydrogen and taking it to the sectors where earlier oil or gas was used. They all mean different technologies. And if we don't put our act together, we'll end up importing these technologies at huge cost. I think I am afraid in the context of e-mobility, that is what is happening. Because we have this great habit of considering whatever is imported is better than whatever we do ourselves. But, you know, it builds in challenges. So I'm not going to go into detail of this. It's a very complex kind of thing to deal with. It will take a lot of time. But just to list the new thrust areas to decarbonize energy use. Top, of course, as anybody would imagine, and everybody talks about it, is electric mobility. But I think even more important is hydrogen electric mobility. That is, you produce hydrogen and then have a fuel cell on board a mobile platform, car or bus or truck or whatever and produce electricity, and then you have the electric traction. And I am more than convinced, particularly for heavy vehicles where there is a range anxiety even today, because we don't have battery capacities of which will give you adequate range. Now, if you have a fuel cell conversion efficiency is very high compared to IC engine. And so, in fact, some calculations which I have seen tell me that you produce hydrogen using biomass, you produce electricity using fuel cell and run the electric traction, you can actually be cost competitive compared to diesel transportation even today. And I think some experiment is being done. But if that happens, that the range anxiety will vanish and will move towards hydrogen economy. The same thing is true about leveraging surplus agri residue to fluid fuel, 2G bioethanol, but many other forms of fluid fuel where we have not paid enough attention. Coal to fluid fuel is another area which is important to minimize import bill. And because as you saw, we cannot eliminate coal. Coal is required for us. In the residential area, again, we could think of solar, nuclear, or biomass, converting that to hydrogen and using, if you want electricity, use electricity. If you want hydrogen, you use hydrogen. Then carbon capture, which is becoming very important, heating, refrigeration in a non-fissile energy source. And so these are some of the important areas where I think the country must aggressively work and facilitate energy transition. Now, within that transition, what are the core technologies, critical technologies? And those critical technologies, to my mind, are steam electrolysis, where, for example, you know, today, because we have given importance to renewable energy, and that is a must run, so there are several coal plants which get stranded. And actually, those companies must be suffering financially quite a bit. Now, I think that's a distortion of sorts. I'm very uncomfortable with that scene. What if you have a cogeneration, you produce electricity. If you cannot sell electricity, you produce hydrogen. And you can sell hydrogen whenever there is a market. So you can create that buffer. The same thing can be done by, instead of electrolysis, you can do thermochemical splitting of water, which it's actually a huge technology development, but may take a little more time, but it may be more efficient. Energy stored, we're talking about batteries, but we should also talk about thermal storage and other areas. Production of hydrocarbon substitutes using hydrogen and biomass, and of course, carbon capture utilization and sequestrations. So, friends, the energy challenge before our country is actually very deep, very critical, and very challenging. We have the resources in the country, both energy resources as well as the human capital, provided we deploy them properly, put in right policies to place. We can kind of mobilize our diplomacy to create huge economic advantage for our country. And so I think this is a big challenge, both from energy perspective, from climate change perspective, and also from strategic action, particularly strategic action perspective. So I will leave it there. And for those of you who are interested in further reading, I was involved in writing, or in fact, chairing committees which wrote these three reports, and they are all available in public domain on the websites. And I'd encourage all of you to take a look at it. One is a Technology Vision 2035, which was brought out by TIFAC. One is Nuclear Power India's Development Imperative, which was brought out by Vivekananda International Foundation. And the third is I was chairman of a high-level committee for Ministry of Oil, Gas, Oil and Natural Gas. And that high-level committee brought out this report. And I think there are several aspects of energy are discussed in significant detail in these reports. So with this, I thank you for patient listening. Of course, I leave it to Dr. Arvind Kumar, but I'd be happy to answer any questions if there are. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. As always, we always learn from your presentation. I think today you again given us a lot of new ideas and shared your objective assessment, and was really very, very comprehensive. Sir, will you take a couple of questions, sir?
Yes, sir, surely.
Yeah, so those of you who have questions, you can raise your hands. And those of you who are sitting in the classroom, you can go to that desktop and ask question and introduce yourself. Yes, Daksh, you go to the desktop and ask from there.
Sir, I'm doing it from online only, so I'll ask right here.
Okay.
Professor, Doctor, I wanted to ask how sustainable, when you say nuclear energy, is, because as technology is advancing, I've read a couple of reports where they say renewable energy is becoming cheaper and the prospects of storage of excess energy is also increasing. And there's also zero marginal cost of production when it comes to something like wind energy. Whereas when you consider mining of nuclear material elements, that cost also is also involved. Also, sir, wouldn't decommissioning costs also increase the, let's say we have to decommission a plant, wouldn't the overall cost increase when such a scenario occurs? So,
well,
why
good question. Good question. And first of all, I must say that that MIT report and the results which I showed you, they include all these costs. They include cost of solar, which are low. They include cost of nuclear as they are now. They include decommission. Everything is included in that. Talking about our own country, India, we also include decommissioning costs in the tariff of nuclear energy in India. Talking about, of course, you talked about the fueling costs and said the renewable energy, there is hardly any fueling cost. Now, even that cost is accounted for. And even in nuclear, the fueling cost is a very small fraction. It is, of course, not zero, but it is a very small fraction. So the short point that I wish to make is, in fact, that is exactly the unease that I have. This is true that, you know, you raise a bid and people submit tenders, they will quote a tariff of 2 rupees for renewable energy. And that has happened. But that is as far as that particular project is concerned. Now, when the share of renewable energy in the overall grid is small, it probably doesn't make much difference. But imagine when the share of variable energy becomes 30% or 50%, then the grid has to be stabilized. And that grid has to be stabilized by, of course, storage is one action, but you have to also create a lot of control features. And in addition to those control features, there has to be sometimes when you suddenly lose power, so you have to have balancing power. Many people talk about gas as a balancing power. Sometimes there is excess renewable energy. So, for example, I talked about stranded asset. Coal has to be kind of brought, taken out of the grid or operated at lower power. Now, all these things means cost. And who pays that cost? That cost is paid by a taxpayer. So comparing as against the project developer has benefited. You are creating benefit for the project developer by saying that solar is cheap. You must compare them at the level of systems cost. And that is exactly what that MIT report does. Unfortunately, we don't do that. And so we have this, we're actually creating an undue advantage for these early project developers at the cost of Indian public. Again, sorry for using harsh words, but I must use that to kind of drive that point home. So if you ask a question, is solar energy cheaper? Yes, it is cheaper, but it is cheaper for the specific buyer and specific project developer. When the proportion of solar energy becomes large, it is going to cost dear to the whole country as a whole. And so when we take decisions, we must talk about country as a whole and take our decisions. And that is the central point that we need to understand.
And one point I would like to add here, sir.
Yeah.
The way nuclear reactor technology has got unfolded across the globe, more the megawatt, less the price. Now,
yes.
Anyone has come up with a nuclear reactor having 1,600 megawatt of nuclear capacity. And that, again, is going to be very effective, cost effective. So I think a lot of things are happening where the cost of nuclear energy is going to be very low.
Yeah, in fact, there is huge amount of literature, and particularly last 1 or 2 years, this has come up in abundant measure, where it says that you want to manage climate, you cannot do without nuclear unless you are prepared to spend huge sums of money. And yeah. Germany is a classic example.
Yeah. We have one PhD scholar, I think she has raised her hand.
Yeah.
Anukma, can you introduce yourself and ask the question?
Hello, sir. My name is Anupama. Thank you for the very illuminating lecture. Sir, my question is, what are some of the impediments or concerns that India would have to overcome in order to sell or transfer its nuclear reactor technology to countries in its neighborhood or extended neighborhood? Because this can be a matter that gives tremendous diplomatic leverage for India. Thank you, sir.
Yes, actually, see, the nuclear technology is sensitive. And so we'll have to be choosy where we can sell and where we should not be selling. But having said that, it's also important to recognize that the export of nuclear reactors, and this, of course, these will be, first of all, we are making this reactor proliferation resistant. So a good part of concern is kind of technologically addressed. But secondly, this will all happen under IAEA safeguards. So those are a must that has to be done. But if we really export nuclear reactors to friendly countries, in the neighborhood or in the emerging economy areas, and there are many where India can leverage to a great advantage. I think it is it serves many purposes, both in terms of dealing with external world as well as addressing the gains to Indian economy. And of course, nothing is simple. You know, I may say export a reactor, it's not so easy. And other countries, you know, although we have kind of, you know, exemption from NSG restrictions, but there is this marketing competition. So nobody is going to allow you to export just like that. And all kinds of arguments and diplomatic moves would be made. So it is a diplomatic challenge, and it's a diplomatic challenge, it's a marketing challenge, but that is what all exporting countries do. And if you want to be counted among in the world, we should learn to be able to do that, and that is what strategic activity and strategic actions are. One big dimension of that.
Sir, shall we think of coming up with a study on the patterns of MIT study?
Well, I think NPCIL is talking about getting that study done, and I think they're talking to Vivekananda International Foundation. But I think such studies are important, and one study is certainly not going to be enough. You must have multiple studies, because you know a study is as good as the assumptions made and the algorithms used. So you certainly need multiple studies, and if you can address one at Manipal, that's great.
Okay. Sure. Thank you, sir. Sir, see, Sadrichari has a question for you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Sir. It was a very, very illuminating talk and thought-provoking. In this slide number 11, we have the new thrust areas. What about thorium-based power plants? Will they be? There is a study that they are much safer and cheaper also, and we have very abundant supply of thorium as a fuel. So, are we doing enough as far as thorium-based power plants are concerned?
I think that's an important point. Why I didn't include that here is I want to be consistent with the argument that if you want to do something with climate, you must have large-scale deployable options within next 30 years, you know, 2050. And now, as far as thorium is concerned, of course, I talked about export of Indian PHWR. That is actually fueled with thorium, and that there is a slide where I talked about thorium low enriched uranium fueled PHWR. Now there is, of course, a domestic design advanced heavy water reactor HWR 300. Which is a super safe reactor, and it was done in response to these accidents that we saw in reactors abroad. And there the development is all complete. We have done major experiments and analysis and everything. It is waiting kind of projectization and approval. For I don't know, it's waiting for 10 years. So, there is a third stage of our nuclear power program, which is going to be thorium stage. That will be yet another type of reactor, which is, because the third stage thorium objective has to be realized in sequence. The first stage of uranium reactors, second stage of fast breeder reactors, and then come the thorium reactors. So there is time, and this will not fit in within this time cycle which I am talking about, and that's why I didn't talk about those. But as I said, technology development has to continue, and from long-term sustainable energy needs of country, thorium is very important, and there is enough body of work which can be acted upon now, and plus going forward work towards third stage of nuclear power program. So that of course must continue, but here I'm addressing only those things which either can be done before can be done, not just done, deployed on a large scale before 2050, or they must be deployed before 2050. There is no escape. Because some of them, of course, are technological challenges, but we must do it. Otherwise, we will have difficulties. So such things I have included here. But you are right, thorium is important. It's in terms of long-term priority number one for the country.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think perhaps the last question by one of our postgraduate students, Meenu, you have raised your hand.
Yes, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yes.
Yes.
Can you introduce yourself? Yeah. Go ahead.
Yes. Very good evening to all the respective faculties. And my question is first of all, I would like to thank all of you for a very insightful lecture. And my question is, sir, as you very rightly mentioned about the Fukushima incident and the sensitivity of nuclear technology, so I would like to know from your arguments in favor and against the nuclear power plants, especially when it comes to environmental and health security or health issues. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. See, nuclear power plants or nuclear power, there are serious, what shall I say, perceptional problems. And I'll like to answer this question in some detail. What do I mean by perceptional problem? I often give a comparison with transportation sector. See, I want to go from place A to place B, maybe 500 kilometer or 1,000 kilometer or something like that. So the options are, I can fly down, I can travel by train, or I can travel on road. Now, there was time in India when if one goes, one travels by air, immediately you carry out your check-in, there used to be an insurance counter, air insurance counter opposite, and we would take a separate air insurance over and above what airline insures all of us for. And that is a feeling. And I know there are many people who never used to travel by air, fearing that that accident could be deadly. And the perception would be that travel by on the road, because you can drive at your own speed and you are always touching on the ground, so you cannot fall down, would be the safest. I would request you to just search Google and ask a question about, you know, fatalities. Compare different modes of transport based on fatalities per passenger kilometer traveled. And you would find that air travel is the safest, minimum fatalities. Train, railway transport will come next, and road transport will have highest fatality per passenger kilometer. But in our perception, we'll always feel, because, you know, this accidents, one accident is big. So I think we need to recognize that see, there is nothing like zero risk. There is always some risk. And what one has to worry about is the cost benefit. And if you look at it on that cost, objective cost benefit aspect, you'll find air travel the best, followed by train travel, followed by car or road travel. I think same thing is true in the context of energy. You can again go to Google and ask a question, fatalities per unit of electricity produced, and ask them to compare different modes of electricity generation. And you would think nuclear will come on top somewhere, and you actually look at the Google and you'll find nuclear comes at the very bottom. Actually, much below wind, but sometimes even below solar. Now, but at the same time, an accident, nuclear accident, is frightful. So the cost benefit versus the trauma that nuclear energy causes, there are two different things that we need to understand. This is point number one. Unfortunately, the exposure of humanity to nuclear energy came through Hiroshima Nagasaki nuclear bomb explosions, which killed a large number of people. So even today, when media talks about nuclear, even a small minor accident, which is trivial, they will show a mushroom cloud. And that is what is sitting in our minds. So this is one of the challenges that nuclear energy faces. Now, I'm not justifying accidents. And nuclear technology has learned the improvement, and technology is becoming safer and safer. A lot has been learned from Mile Island, and a lot has been learned from Chernobyl, and a lot has been learned from Fukushima. And I told you that Japanese government, in spite of suffering both atom bomb explosion as well as Fukushima reactor damage, has decided to carry on with nuclear. In fact, this the public perception problem is strongest in Japan. But so the question is, for them, it is still the best option. Best option is that it's a mix. It's not 100% nuclear, but it certainly is an important part of that mix. So I think we need to learn to be objective and also keep improving technology. In fact, early days, people used to come and ask me, particularly people from abroad, IAEA and all, that how can a country which is a bullock cart economy talk about high technology like nuclear? And they used to raise safety issue just on that count. Finally, we had to convince them that, look, you have to change your opinion about India. We are an advanced, responsible country with advanced capability in nuclear technology. And finally, world agreed to that. I think this aspect of engaging with public, and I think their apprehensions have to be given due importance. They have to be explained. But at the end of the day, there are larger perceptional issues than real issues.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
We will be concluding this session. And I have a present duty to propose vote of thanks. Let me at the outset thank Dr. Anil Kakodkar for sharing his ideas in a very comprehensive manner, and also giving us certain areas of greater interest where we can take up as a part of our research study, both for the faculty and the research scholars. It is very much a requirement for a country like India to look all these issues from India's perspective. And the way, sir, you have really given us those ideas, we certainly will take up certain areas and conduct a good research study. So I thank you, sir, for your time. You have spared time out of your busy schedule. And as always, I personally have learned a number of things from your lecture in the past, and I will keep learning in the future too. I also thank our esteemed Vice Chancellor, Lieutenant General Dr. M.D. Venkatesh, for sitting through. We are really delighted that this shows that the way Mahe has been attaching importance and putting importance to our department, and he has sat through. So thank you very much, sir, for sparing your time and also delivering your professional address.
And it's an honor and a privilege to listen to Professor Anil Kakodkar.
Thank you so much.
And I thank all the research scholars, all the students, and especially those students who have turned up today physically at the department, listening to this lecture, sitting in the classroom, and really learning from this lecture. I thank one and all. I thank Sri Sadhichari Ji, who sat through the lecture. And obviously, he always raises a question of thorium cycle. And the way, I think that is one important area, because once India gets success in the thorium cycle, I think India does not need to go elsewhere asking for the uranium. And that perhaps would answer India's requirement, and India will become self-sufficient. So I thank one and all. And sir, I would like again to, say that your lecture again has been able to help us in terms of knowing about what is the status of nuclear power going to be by 2050, where the world would really stand, and how India is going to be featuring in that particular understanding. So thank you very much. Thank you one and all.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you and good evening, everybody.
Good evening.